heart. Come just as you are to worship. Come just as you are before your God. Come.
One day every tongue will confess you are Lord. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now.
One day every tongue will confess you are Lord.
One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now.
Oh, come.
Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Come. Just as you are to just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are Lord. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are Lord. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now.
Come.
Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Just as you are to worship. Come. Just as you are before your God. Come.
Praise God.
Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Would you
praise
turn
God.
In for hymnals 184.
Praise the Lord. Good to see everybody tonight. How many enjoyed the revival?
Oh, yes, yes.
I tell you what I told Mike. I said, you know, I said, some of our people learned how to shout. I told Marie, I said, I've never seen Marie run, but she runs to the front. I tell you, it was an awesome time. It was an awesome time. And the Lord, if you missed it, I hate it, because I tell you what, you missed a wonderful move of God.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. He's a good God, and He's worthy of all praise. Yes. And I appreciate the right-hand side of the church coming tonight. I really do, because the left decided not to. God is good. Everybody turn to number 184. He abides. Praise God. Let's worship and praise Jesus.
I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk this pilgrim's way. For the hand of God in all my life I see, and the reason of my bliss, yes, the secret all is this, that the Comforter abides with me. Oh, He abides,
He abides,
He abides. Oh, hallelujah, He abides with me.
I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk this narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me.
Once my heart was full of sin, once I had no peace within, then I heard how Jesus died on the tree.
Then I fell down at His feet, and there came a peace so sweet. Now the Comforter abides with me. He abides.
Oh,
hallelujah, He abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me.
He is with me everywhere,
and and he knows my every care. I'm as happy as a bird and just as free. For the Spirit has control, Jesus satisfies my soul, since the Comforter abides with me. He abides, he abides, oh hallelujah, he abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me. There's no thirsting for the things of the world that taken wings. Long ago I gave him up, and instantly all my night was turned to day, all my burdens rolled away. Now the Comforter abides with me. Oh, he abides, he abides, hallelujah, he abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me.
Oh, he abides,
he abides, he abides, hallelujah, he abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me.
Oh, there's no thirsting for the things of the world, they've taken wings.
Long ago I gave them up, and instantly all my night was turned to day, all my burdens rolled away, for the Comforter abides with me.
Oh, he abides,
he abides, hallelujah, he abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk this narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
Holy God.
Praise
Holy
the
God.
Lord. Praise
hallelujah.
The Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Everybody come around for this last song.
Glory to God. Glory to God.
Praise God.
Praise the wonderful name.
Hallelujah. If you've got a need in your life tonight, God is able. Hallelujah.
Oh, thank God.
All you got to do is ask Him. He's a good God.
Hallelujah.
He's worthy. He's worthy tonight. Everybody sing with us.
What's God going to do tonight?
This last song is
Hallelujah.
One everybody knows.
Oh, Lord.
How great thou art. Everybody sing it with us tonight and rejoice in the Lord. He's here to do a mighty thing for his people.
Hallelujah.
All you got to do is reach out. Praise God. Feel the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Feel Jesus in this place. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord.
God, for what we feel in this place, we give you praise tonight. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made.
Oh, yes. Hallelujah.
Oh, I see the stars. I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe.
Praise God. Come on, church. Let's worship Him.
Then sings
my soul. Hallelujah.
My Savior God to thee.
Oh, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
How great thou art.
Oh, thank you, Lord. Praise God.
Oh, how great thou art.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Savior God to thee.
Oh, thank you, Lord.
Oh, how great,
oh, how great, how great thou art. Come on, church.
How great thou art.
Praise God, praise God.
And when I think,
oh, yes,
that God, his Son, not sparing, sent him to die.
Oh, thank you,
Lord. Oh, I scarce can take it in. Then all cross. My burden gladly bearing. He bled and died just to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. Thou art.
Praise God, praise God.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation, oh, to take me home. What joy shall fill my heart.
Praise God, praise God, praise God.
Oh, then I shall bow in humble adoration. Oh my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Oh, how great thou art. When Christ,
oh, thank you,
shall
Lord,
come.
Praise God, praise God, praise God.
Out of acclamation, and take me home.
Oh, hallelujah.
What joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration. Proclaim, oh my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art.
Oh, thank you, Lord.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Then sings my to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Holy God, Holy God, Holy God. Hallelujah, hallelujah to the Lamb. Lamb of God, Lamb of God, I bless you tonight, oh God. I praise and I glorify the Holy Ghost of God. In the name of Jesus tonight, I bless thee, oh God. Hallelujah, hallelujah to God. Praise ye the Lord, praise ye the Lord. Don't you remember Linda tonight? I think she's getting a bug. Sonia and Michael had to go meet the doctors at the hospital. You know, Mike's dad's in the hospital. Nate called and said he was feeling real bad, so he went home. Kelly's on a business trip. And, of course, I guess David still is. And remember Brother Rob, his son Timmy's got cancer, needs a touch of God. Pastor Larry Mills, preacher I've known since 1992, thereabouts, he really needs a touch from God, needs some deliverance in his life. Amen. Hallelujah. Come here, Ashley. Hallelujah to God. How you doing tonight? Blessed and highly favored of God. I know you know all about God, don't you? And I know you love him. I'm just going to ask God tonight just to begin to move up through you to express his love and his devotion for you. I just want the Holy Ghost of God just to come, and I want you to just the fire of God just move through your body. Would that be all right? You like that, buddy? Well, he's on his way. You should feel the presence of God moving through you right now. Hallelujah. When he comes, you'll feel him. I just want God to express his love to you. You know, a lot of times we know about God, and we talk to God, and we love God, but we never feel that real dynamic anointing and that fire that comes in us like your heart's been turned over, like a can of worms is in it. You know, sometimes God feel that way, and I say, Lord, I feel like a can of worms is in my heart because it's just going this way and going that way. I like to feel that, don't you? Amen. I've been praying for you. I've been praying the blessings of God upon your life, and I just been praying that God would just keep you mindful of him. And I've been binding principalities and powers and rulers of darkness of this world. I ask God to build a hedge about you, and I want you to know that, okay? That's why I'm telling it to you. I'm just going to lay hands on you. Yes. Holy Ghost of God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah to God. Lord, in the name of Jesus right now, Lord. Hallelujah, God. She loves you, Lord. And God, I just want you to make yourself known in a greater measure than you ever have before in her life. I want you to expose her to the anointing of God and that fire, God, that burns within us, Lord. Hallelujah to God in the name of Jesus right now, God. Hallelujah to the Almighty God tonight, mighty God tonight, Lord. Hallelujah, God. And she's had a restful week and a half. And Lord Jesus, I just want you to continue this. And God, before that, Lord, it was just like war, constant war. But God, you've been honoring her, God, and you've been lifting her up in the name of Jesus. Now get ready. When I take my hands off your head, you will feel something from God in Jesus' name. Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Holy God, Holy God. Let's pray over these. Holy Jesus. Hallelujah tonight, Almighty God tonight. Lord, I bring these petitions before you tonight, Lord. God, you know each and every individual, Lord. God, just reach your hand down and rescue Larry Mills. God, break this demonic oppression and vexation out of his life. In the name of Jesus right now, we take authority over it, Lord. Touch the sick and the afflicted. God, those that's out of town, out of the country, Lord, on business trips. I pray the hand of God to watch over them, to bless them, and to protect them tonight, God, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah tonight, God. Just move among your people, Lord. God, we so need your presence in our life tonight, God. We need the fire of God to burn within the soul to keep our flesh under subjection, God. And Lord, we shall glorify thee and magnify thee, Lord, and send your blessings, Lord. Touch Brother Rob's son in the name of Jesus tonight. May the fire of God begin to burn in his body And I curse that cancer that it proceed no further in Jesus' name tonight. And we'll give you the glory and we'll give praise and honor to the holy God that we serve in Jesus' name. Hallelujah to God. All right, you can be seated. I believe a lot of folks be as tired, I believe. Well, I got news for you. I'm tired. I went to bed at 7:30 last night. I went to bed night before at 8:30. Because I don't care what time I go to bed, I'm going to wake up 5:30, 6 o'clock. And of course, I woke up 6:15. But I worked an awful lot during camp meeting, and I was just tired. But I tell you what, it was worth it, wouldn't it?
Yes.
Lord Jesus.
Yes.
Lord Jesus, we had a good time.
I've kind of been flying since.
Norman, what size shoe you wear? Eight and a half. If anybody's got any 8.5 running shoes, bring them to Norma if you're not using them, okay? I mean, for a woman that was out in her back so bad, and she was hurting so bad, and it was going down her hips, and the Lord miraculously touched her. And next day I know, here she is taking laps around the church. And Sister Jones, did you see her running? Well, I mean, it was a fast walk for her, but it was running. But she said the Holy Ghost, she felt the heat of God go down in her body, and she just took off. Hallelujah. I appreciate what God done in our camp meeting. And the ones got the Holy Ghost, baptized, and people healed, and word of the Lord come to many people. You know, just regular apostolic church. Amen. That's the way church is supposed to be. Amen. Hallelujah tonight, oh God. I bless you, Jesus. I bless you. We'll go ahead and send. I don't have no ushers here. Mary, you won't be usher tonight. Holy Ghost of God, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Appreciate you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, and we bless you, and we praise you, and love you in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen.
Sure. Okay, everybody pay attention. Back in the back booth. Please pay attention, back in the back booth. I see you back there, talking while your mama's talking. So, anyway, what we're going to do is we usually, this coming Saturday, we would generally have the ladies' meeting. Everybody knows about that. But we're going to skip it, okay? So, Marie has given up the ladies' meeting in order for us to do another vacation Bible school.
Yes.
And that date is actually the 19th. So, we have so much fun at the Vacation Bible School.
Yes, yes.
We do it just like the kids do it. We even have a Bosley Bunny gift. We pledge allegiance to the flag and we pledge allegiance to the Bible. Then we go out and we play some games and just act like kids. And we just have a blast. And then after we get to eat free, whoop, whoop, and then we get to make a craft. And Sonia's in charge of the crafts this year, so I'm looking forward to seeing what she's got there. But it's not this Saturday, but keep the next Saturday open because we're going to do Vacation Bible School one more time. How many's excited about VBS? I'm excited about that. Are you, Elizabeth? You didn't raise your hand. How many's excited about VBS? Raise your hand. Okay, good job. So I'm looking forward to, okay, and matter of fact, I've decided to name it WVBS, Women's Vacation Bible School.
Very good, Susan.
So,
very good.
Yeah, Shirley told me to do that.
Very good.
And right now we're going to have our featured singer, which is Sister Marie.
People have reasons for everything they do. There's a difference between an excuse and a reason.
An excuse is a choice you make with nothing to back it up. That's why a lot of people aren't at church. They've got excuses. I've got to do this. I've got to do that. But when you have a reason for something, it's something that really truly exists and something that you can back up. One of my friends back home, Brother Wiley Reinhardt, is a pastor. He was in my Sunday school class as a teenager, and I'm awfully proud of the fact that he is continuing on the work of the Lord and a fine pastor. His wife sang this song not too long ago. He is the reason I live, and oh, what a reason. I've been blessed with a lot of things. God's been good to me. I have family and friends who share in all I do. But if I lose it all and I'm left with nothing, if I have the Lord, then I know I'll make it through. He's the only reason I live, and oh, what a reason. Yes, he's the only reason I live, and oh, what a reason. There is nothing in this world worth living for. It only leaves you empty and longing for more. Oh, he's the only reason I live, and oh, what a reason. You may have tried a lot of things to find real happiness, but if you've looked very long, then you know that it just can't be found. Until you've found the Lord in the power of His Spirit, His Holy Spirit, oh, Jesus will be your reason to live. He'll never ever let you down. He's the reason I live, and oh, what a reason. Yes, he's the only reason I live, and oh, what a reason. There is nothing in this world worth living for. It only leaves you empty and longing for more. Oh, he's the only reason I live, and oh, what a reason. Oh, he's the only reason I live. And oh, what a reason. You see, there is nothing in this world worth living for. It only leaves you empty, longing for more. He's the only reason I live. And oh, what a reason. There is nothing in this world worth living for. It only
empty, longing for more. He's the only reason I live. Oh, what a reason.
Oh, hallelujah to God. I tell you, Jesus is easy to love. Jesus is easy to love. I appreciate the Lord. I really do. God has been so good to me. Amen. And I thank Him for all the blessings and all the things He's done in my life. I thank Him for the opportunity to serve Him and to be a servant to y'all. A lot of times the ministry, they think they're cut above and they think they should be served. That's contrary to the Bible. Jesus said this, I didn't come to be served, but I come to serve. And He gave His disciples an example how He washed their feet. A lot of preachers like to be pampered and petted and act like they're some kind of, and they're nothing but a servant. We're servants of God, and we're servants of the people. And that's what God called us to be, is be servants. And I guess what you are too. You're a servant to the Lord, and you're a servant to people that you can reach out and help and minister to their lives. I want you to go with me in John 20, 19 through 22. I won't keep you long. That's what Elizabeth Taylor told her husband, said, I won't keep you long. So I won't keep y'all long. I want to speak on the subject, power to live and power to serve. Power to live and power to serve. And we're going to really sort of text from a couple places here. But I'll just sort of go over it with you a little bit. And the same day at evening, being the first day. Now this is after Jesus Christ has been crucified and He is resurrected. And the same day at the evening, being the first day of the week, being Sunday. Monday ain't the first day of the week, is Sunday is. Being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews. Christian people's always been persecuted, always will be persecuted up to the end. And they were assembled for fear of the Jews. Came Jesus and stood in the midst and said unto them, peace be unto you. And when He so said, He showed unto them His hands and His side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. And then said Jesus to them again, peace be unto you, as my Father has sent me, even so I send you. And when He had said this, He breathed upon them and said unto them, receive the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins you remit, they are remitted unto them. Whosoever sins you retain, they are retained. Now, Jesus breathed upon them and said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Now, I've heard people say that's when they got the Holy Ghost. No. Couldn't get the Holy Ghost because the Holy Ghost was not given until Jesus was glorified. And Jesus was not glorified until He ascended. If they got the Holy Ghost there, why did He tell them to go and tarry until they be endued with power from on high? So what the point is I want to say here, Jesus wants you to receive the Holy Ghost. He wants you to get the Holy Ghost of God. He wants you to have that peace. He wants you to have that power. He wants you to have that anointing in your life. Because the Holy Ghost, amen, is that keeping power of God that possesses our life. Can you get out of whack with the Holy Ghost in your life? You sure can. You got to let the Holy Ghost lead you and guide you and direct you. See, when you got the Spirit of God in you, and you start getting out of line, then the Holy Ghost corrects you. Is that right? And, you know, like old-time Pentecostal people say, well, you quit this, you'll get the Holy Ghost, you'll quit that, you quit this. That's trash. All you got to do to get the Holy Ghost is repent of your sins. Let God know that you are a believer and that you get the Holy Ghost even before you get baptized. But you do need to get baptized. But the point I'm trying to make here is the Bible said God gives the Holy Ghost to them that believe. It is a gift from God. It's not something that you have to do to earn it. You cannot earn it. You cannot buy it. You cannot hope it in. You cannot wish it in. You cannot beg it in. You cannot say, please, 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 give me the Holy Ghost of God. Nobody pleads and begs for a gift from God. It's a gift. You just have to open your mouth and let the Holy Ghost of God come into you. Now, I'm still fighting this thinking cold. John 15, verse 26. And when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. And he also shall bear witness, because you have been with me from the beginning. I got a question for you. How do you testify? How do you testify? What? Your mouth. I was getting a lot of sign language there. The Holy Ghost will testify of himself. He will testify that he's took his abode in you, and he will constantly testify of the greatness of God. Now we understand that the Holy Ghost, as Jesus said, is a comforter. What is a comforter? It's an advocate. What does an advocate do? He's a lawyer. He's a day's man. He's somebody that intercedes on your behalf. That's why it's so important. That's why God gives us the prayer language of the Holy Ghost. And when I get to praying in the Spirit, I don't try to stop. I just let it pray, because the Bible says the Spirit knows what we have need of. You can pray all day in English, and you're praying out of your heart. But if you get to praying in the Holy Ghost of God, and the Holy Ghost gets to praying, he gets to praying for what you need and what you need God to do in your life. And he knows every principle. See, the Holy Ghost can see around the corner. He can see back behind the wall. He can see things that's going to come up on you, and he can intercede for you and prepare for you for these kind of things. So the Holy Ghost is an advocate. He's your intercessor. He's your, another word definition of it, is a assistance. He gives you assistance in this life. He assists you in making decisions. He assists you in doing the right kind of thing. He assists you when you read the Bible. He assists you when you pray. He assists you when you're talking to somebody about the things of God. I've had multitudes of people tell me through the years, you know, I got to talking to somebody and stuff started coming out of my mouth. I didn't think when I was saying it, I was saying, where in the world is this coming from? It was coming from your assistant. He was giving you words to say, because the whole Bible says, don't worry of what you got to say, for the Holy Ghost will give you in that hour of what to say. The Holy Ghost knows what to be said. Amen. And I love praying in the Spirit. When I pray in the Spirit, I feel the power of God. I feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost of God. So we understand that the Holy Ghost is our comforter. As the Spirit of truth,
Jesus said he would bear witness. He lets us know and bears witness of the resurrection and the ascension of Jesus Christ. How do we know Jesus? Somebody say, well, how do you know Jesus died? How do you know that he rose? I said, because I got what he said he'd send back. Well, how you know? I said, well, I said, he done exactly what the Word of God said he'll do. He cleansed me from all unrighteousness and sin. He gave me a clean slate, and I feel good. The load of sin was lifted. I see. That's the way the Holy Ghost verifies and testifies that the Word of God will do exactly what it says it'll do. And a person with an experience is not never at the mercy of somebody that's got an argument. Oh, when I was young in the Lord and got the Holy Ghost and come back and try to tell these rough bunch of electricians I was working with, come find out every one of them was saved. They sure didn't act like it. I was doing the same thing they was doing, and I knowed I was lost. But when I got saved and told them I got the Holy Ghost, and they started laughing at me. You roll in the floor and you shake and quake. I said, well, whatever it takes. I said, I know one thing, I got the Holy Ghost. One said, well, the Holy Ghost said, it's of the devil. My preacher said it was of the devil. I said, well, hallelujah. How can God give me something, cause me to change from the devil's way? I said, that don't even make good sense. Ignorant people, when it comes to things of God, they don't know the Bible. They don't read the Bible. Amen. You got to know the Bible for yourself. And if you get the Holy Ghost in your life and you walk in the Spirit and not walk in the flesh, anybody here ever walked in the flesh besides me? Well, thank God I'm not the only one. Hallelujah. Because I'm telling you, you get in the flesh and you can do some crazy stuff that you regret and you repent of it, make it right, do your best to go on. Is that right? But because we got the Holy Ghost, it does not mean that we cannot get in our flesh. We are not supposed to get in our flesh and walk in our flesh, but sometimes we neglect the motivation that the Holy Ghost of God's trying to bring into us and direct us. So to speak, we lay him on the shelf for a minute or two. When that temper flies up, you know, or whatever it is, or, you know, it's just something that happens. But it will testify and bear witness of the resurrection and the ascension of Jesus Christ, because Jesus said that after he was glorified that he would send the Holy Ghost back, and we know that we got the Holy Ghost, so the Holy Ghost bears witness that we understand and know by the gift of the Spirit of God that Jesus did die, that he did resurrect, and that he did ascend into heaven. And he's going to prepare a place for us, that where he is, there we might be also. He gives us he gives followers of Jesus power. What is power? Dunamis power. Dynamite. Ability. Delegated authority. I give you power over all the power of the enemy. That word there is delegated. Power of attorney, so to speak. Maybe you understand that phrase a little better. In other words, Jesus signed the paper and said, here, you go do my work. You got the authority. I delegate this authority to you. I've traded vehicles before you owned, didn't have my title. And I decided to sign my name, giving them power attorney to act on my part to sign my name. And that's what Jesus did when he gave us the Holy Ghost. He gave us power of attorney to operate here on earth on behalf of the Lord Jesus Christ, on behalf of the kingdom of God. And he said, when the devil comes along, he said, you got authority over him. Just take your authority over him and put him in his place. It's like them devils said to Paul, these seven sons of Sceva, children of the priesthood. Oh, hallelujah, they was of the religious sect. And they went up to this guy, had these devils in him, and said, I adjure you by Jesus that Paul preaches. That devil went, He said, man, he said, Jesus I know, but who are you? Now, I've had them say this to me. I know who you are.
I think Amy had a little encounter one time, and the devil told her, I know your daddy. So, you know, when I cast them out, you know, they talk back at me and all that kind of stuff. But, you know, we have power over them. I've given permission. I've been given the right. And so have you. We've been given permission. We've been given delegated authority. We've been given power over the devil. We have permission from the man himself. I mean the big man. We have permission with the creator of the heaven and earth to say, devil, I got your number, son. Jesus done give me that power and ability and authority. When they saw Jesus coming, they fall down and say, I know who you are, the Holy One of God. Don't torment us before our time. He knows who ain't afraid of him. And he knows who's afraid of him. I told you, you know, here, what, 2 or 3 months ago, ever I was being, I cast 4 devils out of this guy one morning. But I just walked in that door and he looked at me and said, I'm Satan. I said, well, really? I said, I don't know who you are, but you're getting ready to come out. I didn't want to fool with it. I mean, I was prayed up, packed up, and I knew I wasn't going to take a lot of time fooling with that dude, them dudes. Just cast them out. Why? 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 The Holy Ghost. Within ourselves, we had no ability to do anything. We cannot accomplish anything. Matter of fact, Jesus says this. Jesus said, you can't do nothing without me. I mean, we might try. We might try to do a lot of things. But you cannot accomplish spiritual things without the Spirit of God behind you. A lot of times y'all see me walk around up here praying and this, that, and other. I'm walking around praying and I'm asking God, I want to do this and I want to do that. You're going to back me up. You're going to back me up. You know, you converse with God. You talk to him about your plans. And you say, is any specific thing that you want me to do? I want to step out on a limb. I want to try to help somebody. I want to try to get somebody healed. What if you fail? Well, what if I do? I can't do it anyhow. It takes the Holy Ghost of God in me to do it. So how can I fail? I can't. Well, somebody might not get hit. Well, what does that matter? I didn't fail. I tried. So as followers of Jesus, the followers of Jesus has power to be a witness of Jesus Christ. The Holy Ghost is for divine service of God and is the divine equipment of God that God has equipped the saints. Why did God equip the saints? Why did God equip the saints? For what? The work of the ministry. God has equipped us with the Holy Ghost of God to do the works of God. You think Jesus is coming back after a lesser church than he left? Don't think so. He's coming back after a glorious church. You remember me preaching about angelic escort? Believe me, the ones that's in the church, in the true church, this is Bible now, this ain't Brother Mike. The Bible said he'll send his angels among them and take them out for the binding. Why? So that my church might shine. You can't do a work through unbelief. You remember the girl I baptized? Y'all saw the lady I baptized? One day I walked in and prayed. And God said, go to Calvin Mayberry's church. I went. And it took her and her mother to bring her dad in. He had a stroke. I'm sitting there meditating, waiting on getting up to preach. God said, when you get done preaching, move the chairs out of the way. I'm going to heal him. So, when I got done preaching, I called him out, and I said, God's going to heal you. And I prayed for him. I mean, he could not operate on his own, period.
And he walked out of the church on his own power, went to a restaurant, drunk coffee with that dead side of his body. He stayed healed for, I guess, a year. Now, this is worth telling. And I come in one day, about middle of the day, and I hit my knees like I did a lot of times, and I prayed. God said, go to Calvin Mayberry's tonight. Okay. So I told my wife, she goes, going to Calvin's tonight. So I went to Calvin's tonight, and he said, it's our last service in this building. I've asked Danny to preach. I said, no problem. I just knew I was supposed to be there. I didn't preach, but I knew I was supposed to be there. And I'm sitting there, you know, music going, I'm worshiping, oh, Jesus, and I hear this commotion like I heard a year ago. Here come the daughter and the mother and their husband back like he was. I got sick. I got nauseated. And I said, after service, I said, what happened? I couldn't tell you, Brother Mike. Said he stayed healed. He said within a month, he got back like he was. I said, did he ever get saved? And they said, nope. I said, I prayed for you for something, didn't I? Yeah, yeah. What about, yeah, I'm healed. And when I was sick. To see a miraculous miracle. And then see the devil steal it back. I got in the truck and I was coming through Boonville, little town. I said, God of mercy, I do not understand this. He said, son, the first time I sent you out here, I want you to see the power of faith. He said, this time, I want to show you what the power of unbelief will do to a people, do to a person, even if they've received a miracle. The power of unbelief. Now, what I tell you all the time, God heals you. And you start feeling that symptom. You liar, you liar. God heal me. I pray. A lot of times when I pray for various afflictions and things in people, I carry that the next day. Don't ask me why, but I always have. I couldn't hardly go. I prayed for you, for your back. What was that? What day was that? Was it Sunday morning? It was Monday morning. I got up, Murray. God, I was hurting all back here. And I said, oh, I know what it is. I said, I know what it is. I told Susan, I said, when I prayed for her, I said, the enemy's trying to bring it on me. But I just, during the day, I talked to God. And I said, devil, you ain't having this, ain't having this. And before the day was over, it was gone. But I could have said, oh, my God, I thought God healed me back under. I'd be back in the shape I was in. The Bible said when the good seed of God is sown, the enemy comes immediately to steal it away. That's why you got to have the Holy Ghost and let the Holy Ghost intercede for you. And you got to let the Holy Ghost increase your wisdom, knowledge, and faith of what the Bible says about healing, salvation, or whatever it might be. The Holy Ghost is your assistant. He assists you in your everyday walk with God. He's your assistant. Anybody here ever had an assistant? Huh? Susan has. Well, I called them helpers when I was an electrician. All right. So the Holy Ghost is for divine service of God and the divine equipment of God to equip the church for the work of the ministry. Now let's see what Hebrews says, okay? I'll show you what Hebrews said, chapter 2, verse 1 through 4. Therefore we ought to give more earnest heed unto the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Now, that's important right there. We ought to give more earnest heed unto things which we have heard, lest any time we let them slip. Now, that word slip is very interesting. It means like a slow drift. I was raised on the New River, okay? And we had currents. I mean, something come down through that, it was just a flying. But when it got to the deep still water, you could watch a leaf. It might take you an hour to get by you. In other words, it's so slow of drift. And that's what happens to people. They let the things of God just gradually and gradually and gradually slip away from us. And when we're told not to let them slip, that we are to give more earnest heed to these things of God and be aware of them and be knowledgeable of them. Excuse me. Every time I start to get fired up, my throat flares up. So I'd stay on even ground here. So lest we let them slip. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, there it is. And every transgression disobedient received a just recompense of their reward. We know that. We read the Bible. We see everybody got what was coming to them. How shall we escape? How are you going to escape? How's this modern church we're going to escape if we neglect so great a salvation which had first begun to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? Who's he talking about? The apostles. They was the one who heard it and they confirmed it to us that they are preaching what Jesus told them to preach. Now, here's the getter. How do we know that we are preaching? How do we know we're in a real apostolic church? How do we know these kind of things? There's a key that shows us that we are working with God and God is working with us. Verse 4. God also bearing them witness both with signs and wonders, divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. Has anybody, y'all seen me pray for the sick? Y'all seen people healed? Y'all seen legs grow? Y'all seen devils cast out? You've seen rotator cuffs healed? Y'all have seen all kind of things. So what does that tell us? What does that tell us? It tells us that God is working with us and we're doing things according to the will and according to the purpose of God. God bearing witness. God is our... Excuse me. See how the flesh can hinder you. So, when you see us here cast out a devil, prophesy, give a word of knowledge, pray for the sick, pray to anybody through the Holy Ghost. Now, we've seen miracles, Lord Jesus. I mean, I've seen bunches because I've been out. Now, what does that tell us? That God bears witness of us with these kind of things. If God is not doing that in other churches, we got a problem. God is not witnessing with them that they're right. I didn't say that. The Bible did. Is that what it said or not? How did he know that it was right? How did they know? He said they heard him. And God bear witness with them by doing the things that Jesus did. Do you understand? But the point is, you can't do these things without the baptism of the Holy Ghost of God. You got to have that power and anointing of God in your life or you can't do these things. Because it's God that does the work. It ain't man. Susan was sitting there down at the house one day. Seth's girlfriend, of course y'all. I prayed for her for two major things. She was fixing to have carpal tunnel surgery on her hand. God instantly healed her. She had locked jaw. God instantly healed her. And they started, I said, let's hold it right here. Did I not, Susan? I said, let's stop it right now. I said, Mike ain't done nothing. I said, all I did was pray. It's God that done the work. I said, I used the tool that God gave me, and I prayed in the name of Jesus, and Jesus was the healer. I said, don't try to make out like I'm something. I said, I ain't nothing but a voice of one crying in the wilderness. I told somebody a story today about that woman called me up saying, hear you the real deal. I thought I was getting some kind of crazy call. It was some woman down in Louisiana. I hear you the real deal. Well, what are you talking about, man? Then she went into detail. Of course, I prayed for her and God healed her. And she, last day, she said, you the real deal, you the real. I said, ma'am, Jesus is the real deal, not me. Forget this. I mean, but you got to be careful. You don't let people pump you up. You get too pumped up, Jesus will deflate you. I don't want to be deflated. I just give him the honor and the glory. I'll tell you something on Brother Mike. And God told me, he chastised me. People's been with me a long time. They knowed that I got up every morning, 2 o'clock in the morning, and prayed and sought God. I did it for years. God woke me up every morning at 2 o'clock. How you know it was God? Well, for 2 mornings in a row, I woke up exactly 2 o'clock, and I looked at it, and I said, the third morning, I said, God, now listen, if this is you're trying to get me to pray, you wake me up, and when I wake up, and I look at the clock, if it says 2 a.m., I will start getting up. Next morning, my eyes flew wide awake. I looked at the clock. It was 2 a.m. Now, this goes on for probably 3 years or longer. I just praying every morning like that. And I would say this phrase. I take pride in the fact I pray a lot. Mistake. Big mistake. I quit waking up. I said, what's going on here? I went to prayer by. I said, God, what's wrong? I said, you're not getting me up 2 o'clock. Be honest with you, it was like you was having a secret affair. It was exciting. I just know when I'm going to get to be with Jesus, man. I was excited about it. And when it stopped and I started praying about it and asking what he said to me, and he didn't say, I drew you to prayer. He said, I drew you to prayer and you gloried in it. I said, oh, forgive me, Jesus, please forgive me, forgive me. I wouldn't tell that on myself. Why not? I'm just showing you. You can get puffed up in the fact that you do pray a lot. But God said, I drew you to prayer. I was the one that drew you to prayer and you gloried in it. And it didn't start back till, several years ago when I started seeking God for gifts of healing, miracles and stuff. And went back to 2 o'clock, coming up here every morning. But I tell you, God ain't going to share his glory, church. He ain't going to share. A church can't take the glory. He'll leave it. You as an individual, you as a preacher, we cannot glory in the fact what things that God has done. Am I being long? If I am, let me know. I don't mean to be. I just get caught up in this stuff. All right, so God bearing him witness. Who's witness? God is the witness that they given it both with signs, wonders, and miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. Who's he doing that for? Those that heard him. He confirmed them that heard them signs, miracles, and wonders. That's why this church is an apostolic church. That's why this church is built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets and Jesus Christ, the chief cornerstone. And that's why the book of Acts is the birthing of the church. And that's why we follow the pattern, the plan of the book of Acts when it comes to praying for the sick, casting devils out, prophesying, laying hands on people, and various things. Now you understand why we're apostolic. Okay? Now Luke 24:29, Jesus said, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with from power on high. Until you what? Be endued with power from on high. What does that mean? That word endued means to clothe oneself or sink down into a garment. What does that mean? You clothe yourself with the Holy Ghost and you just, I got a rollaway bed downstairs and I love to sleep in it. And we had Lila and her brother stay with us a couple weeks while she's getting her house in order. And Mark, he said, I like that bed. He said, you lay down in it, it just wraps around you. That's the way it do me, just wrap around me. So it's like just slipping down into clothes. In other words, you're just being consumed. What does the word baptized mean? To be immersed, to be saturated, to be put under, to be engulfed. And that's what he's trying to tell you when you get the Holy Ghost. Just let it engulf your life. Just clothe yourself with a garment of praise and a garment of righteousness. Just let the Holy Ghost just be your garment and just slip right down into that garment until you be endued with that garment, that power from on high. Huh? That ain't complicated. You want to get the Holy Ghost? It took me approximately, I don't know, 2 or 3 days. Susan got before I did. And I said, go on. I told him. I was mad at him. Mother said, you can't threaten God. I said, I just did. I said, you give her the Holy Ghost. I want the Holy Ghost. And that Sunday night at church, guess what? The Holy Ghost come on me. Now, I didn't speak in tongues, but I got shook and shook and shook and shake every way but loose. But see, the key was when I left the church and went home, I didn't go to bed and watch television. I grabbed a Bible. I started reading. I'd close the Bible. I'd go pray a while. I'd come back, open the Bible. I'd pray. I'd read again. I'd pray again. I'd read. Finally, about 1:15 in the morning, this last time I shut the Bible and got up, throwed my hands up to God and started praying. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, bye-bye. You know, it just started rolling out of me. 1:15 in the morning. At home, them that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. Here's probably what happened. See that? It's about right there. That's about where I was when I left the church. I had about that much of the Holy Ghost. But when I, but 1:15 in the morning, yeah, I went to work next day. I was filled. My cup was running over. It changed my life. And I was smoking, trying to get the Holy Ghost. Hey, I tried to quit, but I couldn't. It wasn't that, say somebody said, you quit cigarettes, God will give you the Holy Ghost. Well, guess what? I was smoking when I got it. But here's the key to it. I'd gone a whole week and realized, hey, you ain't had your Marlboro. I said, well, glory. God, just, I was so excited about the baptism of the Holy Ghost. But I'd cut down about probably 8 a day or something. I was really trying to quit, but I couldn't. Them things is addictive. Them things is powerful. And I tell you what, it about takes God to deliver you from it. But I was trying to get the Holy Ghost. I still puffed a little bit. And God didn't care. I wanted it. I believed it. And I got it. And when I got it, like I say, I'd gone a week and said, hey, I just dawned on me. I hadn't smoked. It had not entered my mind. Because that ache was nothing, John Jones, before God in my mind for that week but Jesus. That's all I thought about. I mean, the Holy Ghost, man, it's something else. I can't explain it to you, the greatness of it. It's so powerful. It's so dynamic. It's so rewarding, refreshing, and renewing, and so peaceful. I mean, I loved laying down at bed at night, and I'd say, God, what a peaceful day I've had. I've had a blessed day. You have given me a great day. And it feels so good to lay down at night. I ain't robbed God. I ain't done none of that stuff. I ain't cussed nobody out. I try to be good to people. I've read, I've prayed, I've done it all, you know, like we're supposed to do. You know, it feels good to lay down at night with that peacefulness and that rest of God. It's an awesome thing, ain't it, Murray? But God Almighty, that Holy Ghost, wow, it's a good thing. And church is what gets me. Churches preach against it. Say that ain't real, died out with the apostles. How can God die out? The Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God. How can it die out? How can it die out? The gifts of the Spirit died out. Why come we still operating in them? How come other churches still operating in them? You know, if God don't do that no more. I was in an apostolic church praying for the sick, and God was doing great stuff. Well, Corey told you, you know, how he was afraid of me and said, don't touch me. You know, God was doing stuff. And the pastor gets up and says, I didn't know God still done that. Duh. When did he stop? When did he stop? Well, I can see I ain't going to get all this done, but that's all right. As long as I get my point across. Have I got my point across? So Jesus said, He said, tarry until you be endued with power from on high. To be clothed one, like to clothe oneself or sinking down into a garment. So he told disciples not to go out. Why did he tell disciples not to go out? He said, now don't you go out and try to preach. Don't go out and do nothing. Because he knew the strength of the forces of evil that they was going to be confronted with. And that's why God gives us the Holy Ghost. He don't want you to go out. Acts 1:1-8. You shall receive power. How did it come in? Like a mighty rushing wind. What does the rushing wind demonstrate? Well, won't you just go get you a tornado and get in front of it? You'll find out real quick. You'll find out. Just go down and where was it? That hurricane went through 100 and some mile an hour winds. Yeah, we're just going to ask him people what wind represents. Power. Holy Ghost come in like a mighty, not just a, but a, it appealed the house where they were sitting. My God, when they got thrown in prison, got taken out, you know, got out and began to pray, and the Bible said the place they were praying, and they were refilled with the Holy Ghost, and filled with the Holy Ghost, that means they stirred it up, and the place was shaking. We need this place to shake. Some people go running outside, think we had an earthquake. I ain't going back in our house. Oh, Jesus. There's so much to talk about. So much to embrace when it comes to the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And about everybody in here, I think's got it. Thank God. And I think we've had about 20, 21 get it since April. So, and I want you to understand this, please. I do not take anything away from your walk with God. You gotta have a pretty good walk with God to sit under me. I tell you that. Because I throw out some pretty good stuff. I ain't taking away. And don't never take it like I'm preaching down on you. I am not. I just want you to have all that God's got for you. And God wants you to have it. And you don't have to be here to get it. My two sisters got it at home. I got it at home. Mother might even got it at home. It's everywhere you want it. I know a guy was out in the woodshed. I know a preacher, a Baptist preacher, was in the corner of his garage, and he dared say this to God. If this Holy Ghost is real, I want it. If it's real, you got to show me, and I want it. I talked to him personally. He said, I found myself on the other side of the garage. Over in the corner side, talking in the heavenly language. It's like John. John Jones said, something come out of my mouth and I know it wasn't me. You know? I said, well, what did you do? He said, well, I didn't know what to do. He said, I'd never preached against it, but here I've got a Baptist church and don't, you know, we don't really believe in it that much. He said, I called my closest friend and he come over and God filled him with the Holy Ghost. Now he's got a Holy Ghost filled Baptist church. I preached in a Holy Ghost filled Baptist church baptized in Jesus' name. Up in the mountains, I sure enough did. I preached in the Methodist church. It was Holy Ghost filled. See, God's not a respected person. He gives the Holy Ghost to him and want it. All right, I'm going to quit. I mean, I got a lot more stuff. I got my point across. Right? You understand it? Right? You understand why you're apostolic? Hey, man, I showed you how. What makes you apostolic? Not as a first apostolic of Kernersville. No. Is God confirming it with signs, miracles, and wonders and gifts of the Holy Ghost and gifts of the Spirit. That's what confirms whether you're God's church or not. That's what the Bible said. Don't get mad at me now. Well, I don't believe that preacher. I can't help it. Still in the Bible. Your unbelief doesn't remove it. What do you think, Marie? Yeah. Okay, that's the guy. She thinks it's all right, so that's good enough for me. I know my wife does. She loves me. She loves my preaching. Marie loves me. Elizabeth does. You do, I know you do. All right, we're going to quit. I know you're tired, dear Jesus. I'm beyond tired. I'm exhausted. I dreamed I was truck muffler last night. I woke up exhausted this morning. Little joke there, okay? Truck muffler exhaust. All right, Sunday, let's come in here and have a Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost move of God. See who God might heal or what God might say to somebody. Or say to us, or say to somebody on Facebook or YouTube. Never know what God will do. Never know what God will do. All right, everybody here is Christian. God bless. Love you. Appreciate you. Go home, go to bed. That's what I'm going to do. All right, God bless.